everyone. It's a pretty quick turnover from the last session, but because we have a full program, I would like to start. So if everyone who's outside could please come on in. This afternoon, we will have a workshop on comorbidities. And I would like, we have a talk with some, we'll give a talk with some interactive e-voting questions. So I hope everyone has downloaded the app. If you haven't, you can do it now and you can participate in the voting. After the first three speakers, we will have a short coffee break and then we'll continue with the final three. So I would now like to invite the first speaker up on the stage, Dr. Victor Valcour. Professor Valcour is a professor of medicine with a shared appointment in a division of geriatric medicine and the Department of Neurology. His work crosses disciplines to research and care for cognitive disorders in aging populations and to understand brain injury in the setting of HIV among all ages. His clinical work involves consultations for patients with cognitive disorders at the Memory and Aging Center at the UCSF. He is also the Deputy Director of Search Thailand here in Bangkok, operating research in acute HIV dementia in chronic and markers of dementia in chronic HIV. He is broadly involved in mentoring individuals at all levels of training who are interested in research, and he has extensive global health experience. Today he will talk about neurocognitive function and frailty in people aging with HIV. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you for having me speak on this topic. And it's actually very difficult to follow a whole morning on cure and stick right into aging. I always worry that, in fact, our elders are going to be the last people to be engaged in any of those studies. And certainly it's a population we need to think about carefully and how we can maximize their outcomes. Today I'm going to speak about four things, and I'll be very quick through some of them. The epidemiologic of HIV I think I'll speak about quickly. I wanted to go through some geriatric tenets that could be useful in HIV. I have only one slide trying to convince you that cognitive impairment remains important. Fortunately, Dr. Spudich this morning showed some slides that I might choose to show about immune activation. And then I thought I'd tell you about an emerging challenge we have in geriatric HIV. And for those stream, please don't be on the live stream. Please don't give away the answers. Aging is not just an HIV phenomenon. It's a world phenomenon. And here in the red is an indication of the aging populations in low, middle-income countries compared to those that are not. In the next 30 years, aging will become a true issue around the world, and particularly in countries that don't have a lot of economic capability to provide support for elders as they become more frail. That's not happening here in Thailand either. If you look at 1960, here in your upper left-hand corner, you can see that those in the older age groups really are a smaller proportion to the population. But this is where we're heading. So in fact, this has an implication economically that the number of people in the workforce supporting elders who are not in the workforce is changing tremendously. We call that, we look at that ratio specifically for economic burden and really challenges for resources within a region that may require more assistance in caring for elders and hospitalized elders particularly. HIV aging is really a phenomenon that's occurred mostly in developed countries, but even this slide from Africa indicating here the increasing redness over time, that particularly in sub-Saharan Africa, South Africa, the rate of people living with HIV over 50 is increasing tremendously. But indeed, as I just said, it's mostly occurring at this time in developed countries. Southeast Asia here showing an uptick in the frequency. This is a slide that dates back about 5 years. But the question is also, you know, who cares and how are we going to work with this? For a long time, the aging research community was obsessed with the idea of accelerated aging and markers of accelerated aging. And I think a lot of the people who are driving that have now moved on to cure. To the benefit of the patients who are aging with HIV, because although we could use aging HIV as a model for accelerated aging, really what we want to get to is how do we get this frail elder to the hospital and back in good condition, healthy, and having a good quality of life? How do we want to manage to extend life quality of life expectancy for these elders, and this is the approach that I'm much more keen on than trying to find the fountain of youth in people who are living with HIV as a chronic illness. So you might ask, you know, which geriatric principle would be useful as a construct in geriatric HIV? And I'm going to give you a few seconds to just vote on that. Which of these concepts you think is interesting for geriatric HIV? Geriatric syndromes, frailty, multimorbidity, or would you go with none of the above? Hopefully people downloaded the app, or we'll see like one or two, and I know who it is. It's actually just a question of futility. I want to know how many people say none. Or even awake and vote at all. Maybe people did watch the me on live streamed a few minutes ago, and these are all going to not work out. I would tend to agree with this very much so. I think when you're talking about the population that is aged with HIV right now, the constructs of geriatric syndromes and frailty are not working as well as just considering the interaction of diseases as we look at particularly middle-aged people. Let me tell you just a couple things that I know about being older and taking care of people that are older. This is a slide of me back in 2000, I don't know, early, maybe 2001. I was working in Hawaii at the time. I looked a lot younger. I didn't have gray hair. And I was taking care of people over 50 years of age living with HIV. This woman agreed to be on the front page of the local paper with me and was living with HIV at the time and doing well, I would say, overall, not a lot of morbidity. And then later there was this publication in the New York Times of a very frail individual who had multiple diseases that were occurring, you know, things that you don't tend to see in non-HIV infected populations, like avascular necrosis with bilateral hip replacements. And the point that I would take from these two pictures is just what I've written here. The variability in old age is greater than the variability across ages. And what I mean by that is you can't simply go by chronological age to determine how frail or how vulnerable a person it is. It just doesn't work that way. We've all seen people who are 90, 95 years of age. I've seen patients, I've cared for patients who are smarter than I am at 95 years of age, more alert than I am. A person that I gave a flu shot to, even though she insisted she'd had one, and 2 weeks later I realized that in fact she had. You know, there's a really robust aging that can occur, and then there's a very frail aging that occurs. And so there's a lot of variability that makes it almost useful to have some kind of a way to categorize that. People have looked at these syndromes that occur in geriatric, in old populations, and some of the syndromes can include things as simple as weight loss and low activity and weakness. They as a consequence, they've kind of moved them into this construct of frailty. And when frailty was initially defined, it was defined in very old populations, people over 80 years of age who were not doing very well, and we couldn't tell why they weren't doing well. It wasn't any of the specific diseases, and we couldn't pin it on anything. We'd maximize treatment for everything, and still they were doing well. So people wanted a model of how in that setting can you predict bad outcomes and vulnerability. It's not about a specific disease, but it's across a number of different diseases. And I would say the word I use is a biological vulnerability. People who tend to have bad outcomes, but without having a clear reason why they're having bad outcomes. In clinical practice, this has turned out to be fairly useful. It can predict people who are going to have challenging hospitalizations and can help us identify the types of people that may need more interventions. In research, it's been helpful in late life and particularly in end of life. But in HIV, I think it's really failed us to date. First of all, the frailty phenotype does associate with some of the biological factors of HIV, but they don't seem to add terribly on top of the factors that we already have. And the most critical challenge is that it's not very frequent in the populations where it's been studied. It tends to occur in less than 10%. So people have started talking about a pre-frailty phenotype where you only have to meet one of the criteria, and the criteria are things like weakened hand grip strength or slowness in movement. So I found it rather difficult to use. Perhaps I'm biased as well, because the biggest determinant of a bad outcome in an elder person is the degree to which they have cognitive impairment. We know, in fact, that that's the leading reason why people are hospitalized, yet most frailty indices don't use that a construct of any cognitive impairment whatsoever. We've tended to look a little bit at these syndromes independently, and here are some of the common syndromes that people have tried to quantify in old age. The construct of a syndrome is that, unlike a disease, where you might have a clear biological issue that's causing very clear symptoms and signs that are associated with it, and you target the disease to try to treat all of these signs and symptoms that occur. In the setting of understanding a geriatric syndrome, you almost flip that and you say, we have a number of different things that are contributing to really what the bad outcome in this case is delirium. But delirium is not caused by one specific disease. So people have tried to use this in this setting as well. It does provide a framework for multiple contributing etiologies to one bad outcome. And it focuses your care on function rather than trying to treat any of the individual diseases. For example, you may have somebody who has hip fracture, and instead of really going after the hip fracture itself, you begin to think how this is limiting the individual and how they can be helped through functional approaches. For example, trying to move the bedroom down onto the first floor so they don't have to go upstairs. What's really helpful about these syndromes is it recognizes that poor outcomes may be more than just one individual disease, which is what you would typically see in a younger population. And when you quantify this in people over 50 years of age with HIV, you indeed find uptake of a lot of these. Falls, for example, are frequently indicated. Well, the falls could be because they have neuropathy, it could be because they have some cognitive impairment, or in fact it could be because they're on benzodiazepines or sleepers having difficulty sleep at night. There are a number of different etiologies for it, and you can begin to unravel it by understanding how often it occurs. Likewise with urinary incontinence and even functional limitations. So there's been some benefit to trying to quantify these. The most common syndrome is polypharmacy, and polypharmacy occurs quite often. I had a question in here, but I didn't have enough supportive slides, so I'll just tell you the punchline here is that although the number of antiretroviral medications has decreased over the past decades, the total number of medications has increased. And the number of inappropriate medications that are prescribed when you look at the Lexicon database is higher in HIV-positive patients than HIV-negative patients who are similar of age. And we also looked at the anticholinergic index, which is an index of how these drugs affect the acetylcholine system in the brain, and find that it's elevated, and that could contribute to cognitive impairment. And of course, when you have polypharmacy, one of the biggest challenges is that you have drug-drug interactions that sometimes you don't know about. What was striking to me when we looked at these 87 people is cumulatively they were on well over 1,000 medications, which is a tremendous number of medications in elders. I'm going to quickly pass through multimorbidity because Dr. Reiss is going to speak about it in more detail, but I think it has some clinical importance, and I'm glad to see that the group here thinks so as well. The concept of multimorbidity is really more than comorbidity. It's not that you have one, two, or three different diseases. It's the fact that these one, two, three, and four diseases interact with each other to cause synergistic or additive qualities that exceed what you would expect by just counting the individual diseases. It's a measure of cumulative injury on major organ systems in the body. The VAX index is probably the best approach that has been taken to try to quantify this, where in addition to CD4 cell count and viral load, as well as hepatitis C serology, they begin to add on anemia, kidney function, and liver function to see if there's a cumulative index that can help identify people who are most at risk for bad outcomes. The most striking thing about it is that it correlates strongly with inflammatory factors. And then in my work in cognitive impairment, it also correlates with the degree to which people have cognitive impairment, probably because of an epiphenomenon with the degree of inflammation that correlates to both of these diseases. Really, when you think about the heterogeneity in old age, we hope that most people are here on your left, that they have few health outcome problems and they have a robust life. But there are much fewer people here in the frail and vulnerable side. And really what we try to do in our work is take this arrow and turn it around. It does appear that HIV is causing us to move this curve with fewer people who have fewer health outcome problems and more that begin to have multiple medical problems. But our goal really should be to try to push that over. And a slide that I cannot speak about aging without showing this seminal slide that was published back in 1980 that anyone who's trained in geriatric medicine has seen at least one time. But the goal in a lot of what we do is try to compress morbidity. So indeed, if this is your functional life expectancy and you're going along at 100% and you're doing wonderfully, life is great, fantastic, and then suddenly you were hit by a truck and you go to zero, that's probably an optimal outcome, although I don't want anyone to get hit by a truck until they're ready. But you want to keep the curve as high as you can for as long as you can. Yet some of our HIV patients are beginning to have a curve that looks more like this, where they're carrying multimorbidity, and the goal really is to try to push this curve over. And we can do that in many ways without medications by trying to look at the global functional outcome of individuals. I really don't have time to talk a lot about the persistence of cognitive impairment, but let me ask you as a group, cognitive impairment among patients who adhere to antiretroviral therapy and maintain suppression, these are your optimal outcomes. People completely suppress plasma outcome, then the cognitive impairment that we see is completely due to comorbidity. That's what I'd like to ask you. Essentially, I'm asking if there's an HIV component. So people who are suppressed on antiretroviral medications, then the etiology to cognitive impairment is due to other diseases. Yes or no? True or false? This 30 seconds is too long. 15 seconds, we should go next time. Maybe people have to get the app. So most people are saying that it's true, and there are quite a few people that are saying that indeed it's false. And this is probably a very accurate outcome because it's probably in some ways a mixed bag. The frequency of cognitive impairment after we treated with antiretrovirals remains about 50%. So even when antiretrovirals are available, 50% of the population has cognitive impairment. The real challenging thing about this number that always infuriates me is that the 50% with cognitive impairment after heart, less than 50% of those people were suppressed in the paper that's being cited. So people don't tend to look at an optimally treated population to inform their science. This is something that we've really pushed heavily in meetings and we do in our own lab, is that we try to understand what is happening in people who are suppressed. And the key take-home point that I would want all of you to know is there are excellent data showing that if you are completely suppressed with antiretroviral therapy, you continue to have immune activation in the brain, demonstrating microglial activation. Dr. Spudich mentioned this morning. And that microglial activation is almost certainly due to HIV, somehow continuing to cause a degree of inflammation. So there is absolutely no doubt in my mind that we are not sufficiently treating people to remove all risk for cognitive impairment. Having said that, when you look carefully at papers, comorbidity is a strong influencer of cognitive outcome. So it is in some way a mixed bag. But don't leave this meeting thinking that it's all comorbidities when you see your patients. I think that's a disservice to them. I think there's truly an HIV component that continues. This brings me into what I want to end my talk about is really what I spend most of my time thinking about is what's happening in the brain. And I call this the most pressing geriatric neuro-HIV challenge. And I'm thinking particularly about geriatric meaning over 65 years of age, which is the group that I study in San Francisco, people who are truly in a geriatric population. Well, why does that matter? It's critical when we talk about the brain, because if you're thinking about diseases like Alzheimer's disease, they simply don't exist with any frequency in 55 to 60 year olds. Maybe 0.5% of the population will have an Alzheimer's syndrome. So people who are looking at models of accelerated brain damage that may indicate some level of neurodegenerative disorder that's age associated, yet they're looking at people who are in their 50s are really not looking at a vulnerable population for this. And so we pushed the envelope to try to look at people who are older. And there's a lot of reason to believe this is what the curve looks like in Alzheimer's disease. It doubles every 5 years. So that your risk is about 1% at 60, 65, but by the time you're 70, 75, it's up to 5 or 10%, and by the time you're over 80, your risk for having Alzheimer's disease in the general population is around 25 to 30%. So it goes up exponentially. And there's a very good model of cerebrovascular disease with Alzheimer's disease that shows that you can move this curve up if you have more than one disease. Well, our HIV patients tend to have three diseases. If they have Alzheimer's disease, that would be their first, if they do. The second is cerebrovascular disease, because there's a tremendous amount of cerebrovascular disease in aging HIV patients. And the third is that they have an inflammatory phenotype that could increase their risk for Alzheimer's disease. A paper was published last year showing for the first time, this is how the public relations group at the university advertised this, not the paper, which was much more balanced. For the first time, doctors identify a patient with both Alzheimer's disease and HIV. I can tell you that people who work in memory clinics and see HIV patients have diagnosed this disorder for many years now in some of our older patients living with HIV. But this got a lot of press because it was an individual who was older and developed Alzheimer's disease in the setting of HIV. What was really interesting about this paper is there was a 2-year delay in making his diagnosis, which tells you a little bit about the frequency in which cognitive impairment occurs in HIV and how HIV patients are really at the greatest risk to have a delayed diagnosis for Alzheimer's disease because their symptoms may be brushed off. In this study, they diagnosed Alzheimer's disease in the individual by looking at a PET ligand that picks up amyloid, the key protein that's deposited in the brain during Alzheimer's disease. And in these images, there was uptake of this amyloid that was consistent with the diagnosis of Alzheimer's disease. This is actually probably a very good way to diagnose Alzheimer's disease in older HIV. In my setting, it costs about $4,000 to $5,000 a scan, so it's not a practical approach to doing it. We've begun to look at this a lot, and I've had a lot of individuals who really give me pause about this, and I'll tell you about one that we saw last year. He was 72 years old, right-handed, 18 years of education. He had been diagnosed with HIV in the 1980s with a nadir that was not terribly low, 300. And his CD4 cell currently was almost 700. He was undetectable, and he was on antiretrovirals, which I've shown you here with an integrase inhibitor-based regimen. He'd not had a lot of comorbidities. He had Carposi sarcoma in 2003, and he had hyperlipidemia. He came to see us because he'd had subtle decline in memory and executive functioning. Executive functioning being the patterns of thinking and cognition that are required for you to do complex tasks. He had really not had functional impairment at this time, but he was terribly worried that he had Alzheimer's disease. He had depression that was under treatment, and he'd had it for a long time. He thought it was under good control. And although he had some sleep problems, he was sleeping relatively well overall. We did cognitive testing with a MoCA, which many of you may be familiar with. He scored 24, so he was in the mild cognitive impairment stage, the stage that I think is at most risk for not diagnosing Alzheimer's disease, because once it progresses, it becomes a little bit more clear. But it's not very hard to understand that there's something terribly wrong with this clock. The numbers are backwards. The hands are really not in any clarity. And there's really a visual spatial challenge that we see in both HIV and Alzheimer's disease. But this is unusual. We don't usually see clocks that bad in HIV. And it gave me certainly some concern. When we did a more thorough cognitive testing battery on him, more worry for me. He had true memory problem, visual memory problem. And unlike nearly every HIV patient I've ever seen, he had trouble with language. He was having trouble with categorical fluency. He was having difficulty naming things. So we show him pictures of things, and he should have done well with a master's degree in English language learning. But he was really having problems in an area of thinking that I tend to think of as being spared in HIV. Of course, he also had quite a bit of motor problems here that would be more consistent with HIV. He had some challenge with a sequencing task we call the Lurie sequence. He had some neuropathy that we could identify in his lower extremities. And what worried him the most is he was in his early 70s, and his brother had died of Alzheimer's disease at his age, a little younger. So he was worried. He has a strong family history. This is a worrisome family history for developing Alzheimer's disease himself. So we imaged him, and his image was rather normal. It was read as normal. I reviewed it. I didn't see any focal atrophy. What do you do in the clinic? Now, you're all faced with this challenge. I'm going to start the voting a little early and keep talking because it's so long. What do you do here? Do you do a lumbar puncture on him to see if additional testing can be done? Do you treat for both Alzheimer's disease and HIV, the second choice? Or do you just treat for HIV and just watch to see if he gets worse? What do you do? One, two, or three? Not a lot of choices. I suppose if you don't want to do any, you can just refuse to vote. So, lumbar puncture. Well, this is a reasonable thing to do. I mean, it's a worrisome picture. I can tell you that the duration of his symptoms were quite long, 10 years. I didn't make that quite as clear. And it's worth looking perhaps to see if he has virus in his CSF. Very rare event. Very rare event to see if he has CSF escape. You could do that if you wanted to. You could also measure amyloid and tau in his CSF. Those are markers for Alzheimer's disease. Unfortunately, they're perturbed in a setting of inflammation. Amyloid tends to be dropped. The last person I did an amyloid and tau measure on in CSF, it came back equivocal because his amyloid was low and the tau was normal. It wasn't consistent with Alzheimer's disease. Unfortunately, neuroinflammatory disorders have a problem with this. Well, there's a lot of literature to tell us that, in fact, we could do better with this. If you look at the cognitive testing scores, and you compare this very busy slide, and I apologize, if you compare the cognitive testing scores of HIV and AD, clear patterns, at least historically, that you can differentiate these two. Motor changes are different in the two, and we even find differences in behavior. If we start looking at imaging, we should be able to see focal atrophy, which this individual didn't have. But we should be able to use some of those measures to do it. APOE4, probably not useful at all. Amyloid and tau, probably not useful in CSF, although we'd like to test that in an appropriate population. I can tell you that we've done some machine learning work comparing people with an MCI from Alzheimer's disease with people with HIV-associated cognitive impairment. And with 95% accuracy, using the imaging alone, we could differentiate these two groups. So I think it's quite possible that we can use imaging to distinguish HIV-associated cognitive impairment with Alzheimer's disease, particularly if we add on some cognitive stuff. So I didn't give you the answer on this gentleman. We were fortunate enough to co-enroll him in a study where we could measure amyloid in his brain, and indeed he did not have amyloid in his brain. He did not have Alzheimer's disease. So he has an HIV-related cognitive impairment. I can also tell you that he was so relieved when he heard about that, he would not let us do a lumbar puncture. So we haven't worked him up any further. He really thought, and I did too, that he had Alzheimer's disease. So our future work is really addressing this issue. We have a new initiative that's going to use machine learning to try to differentiate people who are amyloid imaging positive from those that are amyloid imaging negative by HIV group. And I see I'm well over my time, and I'll stop at that. Thanks so much for your attention.
Thank you very much, Professor Valcour, for that talk. Are there any questions from the audience? Yes.
I've seen some patient too, with neurocognitive impairment, one on ART. So do you have any suggestion as a screening test or something to do in a resource-limited setting?
Yeah, that's a great question, and I appreciate you asking. The question is whether there's a screening test that can be used in resource-limited settings to identify people who have cognitive impairment. And let me answer that in two ways. There isn't. It's kind of the easy thing to say. But more importantly, it's to say what not to use. Don't use the International HIV Dementia Scale. It doesn't work. If you want to find dementia, it'll work, but I think you'll figure that out without having to have a screening test for it. Don't use the mini mental status examination. It's available to everybody. It's in our toolbox. We think it's fantastic. It's probably the least sensitive test that you could pick out of your toolbox. The MoCA does a little bit better. We published two papers that it does okay, but it's not fantastic. So we don't really have a great tool to offer, and I think some of the computerized tests may be emerging that will be a little bit better. The second part of my answer would be why, and what are you going to do? And as a person who's really keen on identifying this, I can answer why, in that I want to be people to be able to plan for the future. I want them to be safe, and there are a lot of really good reasons that we want to do it. But I can't tell you how many clinics have asked me to do screening when there are so many other low-hanging fruit that they have to address. There are so many competing priorities. I asked specifically, what would you do differently if you had mild impairment in one clinic? And the person said to me, we would send them for adherence counseling. And the question to me is, why aren't you sending everybody for adherence counseling and picking out those individuals? So I think you have to think about what you're trying to do. In many research settings, people want to quantify how much cognitive impairment is going on. I think that's really tough to do with any screening test. And if you want to really do it, you need to really invest in doing a large battery. If you're trying to find people that are at risk for some of the functional outcomes, maybe the MoCA would help. But I worry you're going to get a lot of false positives from people who are not going to do well on that test as well. And I may not have a great test for you to go after. It might be more helpful to look at their functional limitations and try to see where they're failing and try to address those. But I've gotten to this opinion. I wrote a paper on this in 2011, CID, and it may be a little bit more detail. And over the past few years, I've just become a little bit more pragmatic about it. It's very difficult, particularly in low middle income countries, to address all the challenges of caring for people. I think you need to look for the worst outcomes and try to address the functional outcomes. But I'm not always certain that knowing the frequency to which you have people who don't test well is going to help you generally in your clinic.
Thank you. In the interest of time, yeah, I would like to continue with the next speaker, Professor Peter Reiss. Professor Reiss is a professor of medicine at the Academic Medical Center in Amsterdam, the Netherlands, and he holds a joint appointment in the Department of Global Health and a Division of Infectious Diseases. He has also been the director of the Netherlands HIV Monitoring Foundation since 2013. Professor Reiss serves on the scientific advisory boards and steering committees of several international cohort studies, and he is the clinical HIV section editor for antiviral therapy. His current research focuses primarily on the complications of HIV and HIV treatment, and more particularly in aging individuals with HIV. And today he will talk to us about co- and multimorbidity in people aging with HIV.
Thank you very much for the kind introduction. I apologize in advance because I have a bad cold, so I hope my voice will last. Anyway, it's really a pleasure to be back in Bangkok, and I wanted to start off actually by congratulating Professor Prapan and his team with the immense success of HIV-NAT and all the other work that is going on in Bangkok. And this is a picture actually taken in 1998. Where you see the three co-directors of HIV-NAT, Professor Cooper, Professor Prapan, and the late Professor Joep Lange. And I thought, given the topic of my talk, it was good to show this. There. So as Dr. Valcour already said, I mean, and this is actually a good thing, the population of people living with HIV, at least where they have access to treatment, is increasing. These are data from the Netherlands, where we follow a cohort of everybody with HIV in care, and as you can see, as a result of the success of treatment, the proportion of people who are older is increasing. And modeling work that we did together with a colleague at Imperial College in London shows that fortunately this is only going to increase in the future. These trends are going to occur all over the world, wherever there is access. This is a slide from UNAIDS, which shows different regions of the world, and you see the estimated absolute number of people with HIV over 50, and that number, again, will increase. Victor already showed another slide from that same monograph. So unfortunately, as we age, as everybody ages, age is the largest single risk factor associated with the development of age-associated disease, and there's so far very little that we can do about that. And this is exemplified if you look at, again, a figure from WHO, which looks at the global situation and the probability of dying from four main NCDs, cardiovascular disease, cancer, chronic respiratory disease, and diabetes. And you can see that across the globe, in many areas, except for North America and Western Europe, the chances actually for people between the ages of 30 or 70 to die of these diseases is substantial. So this brings me to my first question. So the question is age-associated co- and multimorbidity more prevalent in HIV? And I ask you to vote, and the possible answers are no, only in women with HIV, yes, and unknown. And I agree with Victor, it's actually too long, the 30 seconds. Underestimating the audience, who is quite much quicker, I'm sure. Thank you. Okay, so the majority, the overall majority is yes, and I agree, and I just wanted to ask this question in introduction to the next, next slide, because we have actually addressed this issue in a cohort study that we've been running in Amsterdam since 2009. It's a prospective observational cohort study, the HIV cohort study, in which we assess people who are 45 years and older, and we compare a group of HIV positive individuals in our HIV clinic to a group of HIV uninfected individuals that are recruited at a sexual health clinic in the city center. So these are people coming for sexual health checkups and obviously at risk of HIV, because we wanted to get a population of people who are hopefully were as much comparable to the HIV infected population except for not having HIV, because we wanted to get at the issue to much extent the issues I'm talking about can be attributed to HIV or treatment related factors. And people are assessed, as I said, every 2 years. In a subset of individuals, we do more in-depth studies, including a lot of neuroimaging and neurocognitive assessments, and that's done really in the context of a European program that we do called COBRA, in which we collaborate with investigators, including investigators in London at Imperial College, who in the UK are running a similar cohort study. And what we found, one of our initial results was, and in this case, and I agree with Victor, we simply calculated the number of comorbid illnesses, not looking at interaction, which I think is a very relevant comment, and we found that multimorbidity, here defined as having three or more additional illnesses, was more prevalent in those with HIV, so more multimorbidity. And if we looked at individual comorbidities, really in a quantitative sense, we saw this across the board for cardiovascular disease, for hypertension, for arterial stiffness that we've been measuring, for low bone mineral density, for significant liver fibrosis, and this in our hands is a population where the amount of viral co-infection is quite limited. We saw it for certain imaging, neuroimaging modalities, as well as for cognitive impairment. Now, this is not particular to our cohort. I've just taken an example of a very large study in the VA in the US, looking again at a comparison of HIV-infected and uninfected individuals, and here looking at hard clinical endpoints of cardiovascular disease, myocardial infarction, and the risk of myocardial infarction was approximately 50% increased, and important, that's at the bottom of the slide, that risk remained virtually unchanged among those with well-treated and suppressed HIV infection. Brings me to the next question. The most important driver of comorbidity in people living with HIV is A, persistent immune activation during antiretroviral therapy, B, age, C, having experienced advanced HIV infection, and D, ART toxicity. Please vote. Okay, that's an interesting distribution. My answer actually would have been B, because as I said before, age, unfortunately, is really the strongest driver for anything that I'm talking about. And of course, what I try to discuss with you today is what additional contribution there is from other factors. But in absolute terms, age is the main driver. Why is this? So with respect to additional drivers, and this is a slide that I've modified slightly from Steve Deeks, the drivers that we currently are considering, and they've been mentioned, of course, already this morning in the symposium, additional drivers are ART toxicity, and that's something which is fortunately changing, but it's still to some extent present. Very importantly, host factors, and I would mainly stress lifestyle-related factors, as well as obviously genetic factors. And then from the perspective of HIV, the concept out there is that persistent immune dysregulation and inflammation, in spite of treatment, although it's down-modulated, also plays a role. And then interestingly enough, there could be an interaction between the inflammation that we actually see in HIV and the actual biological aging process. And I'm not going to talk about that today, and I don't think actually that the answer to that question, whether that's true or false, is something that we know at this moment. So going back to our aging cohort in Amsterdam, what do we find? And this is really a summary, a visual summary of some of our findings. We see that having experienced advanced HIV disease or AIDS, or having had a low nadir CD4 count is really bad across the board, regardless of what outcome we look at. Now, having experienced advanced HIV disease is common, and is something that Irene Cerretti already showed you the data from Europe. These are the data from our own country, where in fact late presentation is also around the proportion of about 40 to 45% in newly diagnosed individuals. And we see that it's more common actually in people who are diagnosed with HIV at older age, at an age over 45. Now that group is interesting. So the group who are newly diagnosed with HIV at a fairly advanced age, because this is a study from Italy from Giovanni Guaraldi, who's working in Modena and is comparing his HIV cohort to the Italian population from that same region. And what he finds is that any age, long-term infected people had a fivefold accentuated risk of multimorbidity than HIV negative controls, while that other group, the more recently infected people who are older, had a sort of intermediate risk. And I think we need more data to look at this, but it's the point I'm trying to make is that group is different probably from the people who were infected at a younger age and have gone through various eras of treatment. Other factors that we find is a symbol that I've used for soluble CD14 as a marker of monocyte activation in the plasma, whereas we found is associated with a number of outcomes, but not necessarily with all outcomes. Having active HCV infection, again, with some but not all outcomes, and the same is true for having been treated with older generation antiretrovirals. So smoking, of course, critical factor really across the board, important factor. And then body composition, waist to hip ratio, increased waist to hip ratio also associated with a number of these outcomes. At the same time also we find that having underweight or actually having experienced underweight in the past, for instance as part of the HIV wasting syndrome, also still is associated with morbidity many years later on. But the point to make is that the associations that we find are not necessarily the same for each of the comorbidities, so the point of caution is that it's quite dangerous, I think, to generalize. So this, I think, is my last question. Hypertension prevalence in people living with HIV has not been associated with body mass index, current or recent use of abacavir, ethnicity, and prior D4T ustavidin use. Please vote. Okay, so the question was not. In fact, the correct answer is B, current recent use of abacavir, because that has been associated with myocardial infarction, but not with hypertension. And the reason why I put the question in is that the association with stavudine use is one of the things that we picked up in our cohort and is actually one of the few morbidities where we found a very clear association with the use of particular prior old drugs. So we find an increased prevalence of hypertension in our HIV positive cohort across the board, regardless of what age category we look at. And when we did the analysis of looking at factors that were associated, we found that there was an association with HIV, so those with HIV had an higher risk, but then if we adjusted the model in addition for the factors listed in red, for waist-to-hip ratio, the association with HIV was reduced, suggesting that at least waist-to-hip ratio was an important factor in mediating the association with HIV. When we looked at the HIV-positive cohort separately, and looked at the association with prior stavudine exposure, we found such an association, and we saw that, again, if we adjusted for waist-to-hip ratio, the association with stavudine was reduced, which suggests that the body composition changes that we all know about in the past associated with stavudine might be mediating, and in particular the lipoatrophy might be mediating the chance of having hypertension down the road. Of course, on top of all the traditional risk factors associated with hypertension. Another issue that I wanted to touch upon is weight gain after the start of ART, and I'm talking about the current era, and is that good or bad? And this is something, this is a topic which is gaining attention, and I think it's probably going to be different in different parts of the world, so I think it would be good if this would be studied in different parts of the world, including here in Thailand. These are data from the US, which suggests that actually weight change in the sense of an increase in weight in the first 12 months after starting ART, if you look as an outcome of mortality, is actually a good thing. However, this is a study from the DAD study looking at morbidity on the top at cardiovascular disease risk and diabetes on the bottom in relation to weight change. It shows that there's actually a difference between the two in the sense that the risk of cardiovascular disease is increased in those who start off before treatment with a normal BMI but not in the other BMI categories, whereas the risk for diabetes seems to be increased across the board of baseline BMI. So these are definitely not definitive data, but I think issues to take into account, especially if you think of managing weight in our patients when they start treatment. Chronic renal impairment is another issue that is important, and in our cohort we find that low estimated eGFR, albuminuria, and proximal renal tubular dysfunction is more prevalent in those with HIV, and we also find that in this well-treated population, there is a greater risk of further decline in eGFR and worsening albuminuria among the treated HIV-positive patients. And this is interesting because the additional analysis shows that this is not totally explained by the use of tenofovir. In fact, those people who had experienced renal problems on tenofovir were already switched on. So whether this is much further low-grade worsening of renal function in those continue to be on tenofovir is something that we're trying to get a handle on. Hopefully, with the advent of TAF, this is something that we might be able to some extent reverse. This is a picture of one of the switch trials from TDF to TAF, which consistently have shown the improvement in tubular markers and to some extent in eGFR. And the clinical relevance of that remains to be determined. So in terms of quality of life for the people with the comorbidities, it's another thing that we've looked at, and we see that if we look at the physical summary scores in the quality of life scales, but not in the mental health scores, we see that the number of comorbidities is associated with worsening quality of life, but the degree to which comorbidity burden affects that is really not different in those with and without HIV. Looking towards the future, again, modeling work from the data, our national cohort in the Netherlands predict that the prevalence of people with multiple comorbidities is going to increase in the future with all the consequences that Dr. Valcour has already discussed. It will be mainly, in our predictions, burden of cardiovascular disease, which again also will be affecting neurocognitive outcomes, diabetes and malignancies, and this will be associated with polypharmacy with cardiovascular disease medications predicted to be contributing the greatest burden. So how are we doing in terms of management? Well, this again, data from our cohort, we're very good at managing HIV and keeping people suppressed. But actually in our HIV clinic, we're not very good at controlling blood pressure and controlling cholesterol. But as you can see, our general practitioners in Amsterdam are not good at doing that in the HIV uninfected cohorts either. And this is something which unfortunately is well known from the general population. So that brings me to the issue of health behaviors, because of all of this basically is a behavioral issue that needs attention. And we know, if we look globally, that cardiovascular disease is the number one killer amongst the NCDs, but it is preventable in the sense that the estimations are that the elimination of bad health risk behaviors could prevent at least 80% of cardiovascular disease, and we could add by using proper drugs, but it's really the behavioral issue which gives you the biggest bang for the buck to fix this problem. This is a very recent study from New England Journal which shows that the issue of improving health behaviors for cardiovascular disease is relevant really regardless of people's genetic underlying risk. So both in people with high and low genetic risk, it's important to improve health behaviors. And if we don't do that, then I think it's an illusion that we will accomplish the third of the Sustainable Development Goals, good health and well-being, which says to ensure healthy lives and promote well-being for all at all ages. Now, I don't want to end on a negative note, so I picked up this paper from the New York Times recently, which showed this story about this 85-year-old marathon walker in Canada, and the title was, "He was so fast that even scientists marvel." So there's hope there out there for all of us. Finally, I'd like to stop by acknowledging our study group, in particular Rosanne van Soest, who helped with a number of the summary slides of the cohort, our European collaborators in the COBRA collaboration, and of course all the study participants without whom these studies would not exist. And with that, I'll stop almost by at least inviting you to my home city, Amsterdam, the Netherlands, next year. I hope you'll all put abstracts into the International AIDS Conference that will be happening in July. But there's another invitation to Amsterdam already this year, and that is for Professor Jintanat's inauguration as Professor of Medicine at our university, which will be on Wednesday, June 21st in Amsterdam, and you're obviously all very welcome to come and see that. With that, I'll end and take any questions. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Professor Reiss, for that very interesting talk. Are there any questions from the audience? I was wondering if, because we're talking about lifestyle changes for cardiovascular disease and quality of life, is there any indication that the impact of lifestyle changes among HIV-infected people might be different or less compared to when you look at an HIV uninfected population, because you have to take into account the effect of HIV?
Yeah, not to my knowledge. At least the studies that I've looked at that I don't think show that. I mean, one analysis that comes to mind is from the DAD collaboration, where we tried to look at the impact of smoking cessation, and the impact seemed to be similar to in the general population. One other thing, talking about smoking, there are data out there that the impact of smoking in HIV may be accentuated compared to the impact of smoking elsewhere. So that really speaks to the point that smoking cessation is so important.
Yeah. Yeah. Okay, that's good news.
So no excuse to try and have good lifestyle.
Yeah. Yeah. Okay, great. Thank you. Are there any other questions? Oh. Okay, thank you very much.
Thank you.
Our next speaker and the last speaker before the break is Professor Tim Cressy. In the program it says that Professor Berger was going to give this talk. Unfortunately, he could not come to Bangkok. So Dr. Tim Cressy has kindly agreed to use part of David's presentation today and talk to us about drug interactions. Dr. Cressy has worked at the Harvard School of Public Health since 2001, where he holds a position within the program program for HIV prevention and treatment group based in Chiang Mai. His clinical studies primarily focus on mother and child health, and he has also performed clinical pharmacokinetic studies, including adults, adolescents, children, pregnant women, and newborns. He's also proficient in performing population PK modeling and simulation studies, and to support the PK studies, he has established a pharmacology lab at the Faculty of Associated Medical Sciences at Chiang Mai University. So today he will talk to us about drug interactions.
Thank you very much for the kind introduction. So firstly, I know that most of you are all disappointed that David is not standing here, and unfortunately you have me, and I know this personally because I said to my friend Ajahn Suryavartana last night, oh, I'm speaking instead of David, and she went, ugh. So I'll try my best. I have David's slides. I added a few myself, so we'll see how it goes. I'm trying to do it justice. This is David's disclosures. I have none as well. So there's three questions right at the beginning, but I'll start now because it takes so long. So David's got three questions at the start. It's like a sort of mini exam, I guess. So the first one is, which of the following ARV drug classes is responsible for the majority of the drug-drug interactions? So A, protease inhibitors, B, integrase, C, NRTIs, and D, NNRTIs. And I see there's a fifth, so if you don't know, just press number 5 maybe, and we can say that's an unknown. So that's the first question. So it's quite a good, everyone's at least had a guess, so it's good news. So we'll move on to the next one. Try to remember what you did before, and then we'll come to the end. So after the presentation, we'll have these three questions again, and we'll try to, maybe you can remember what you did, and then see if you improved. Or got worse, who knows. So which of the following ARV classes is responsible for the I've got done this one already, haven't I? So I will wait. So you can try and change your answer or do something else if you want. Now you saw what other people got. This is going to be, then there's two more questions. You're going to be, the presentation will be finished by the time you finish the questions. So I will try to press, you see? So if I press down next, or so next. Oh no! Okay, so don't worry. So it's question 2. I will start it, so we don't waste time. What is the true? What is true about the class of NNRTI? So this includes efavirenz, nevirapine, etravirine, rilpivirine. They're all inhibitors of CYP3A4. They're all inhibitors of 2D6. Only efavirenz and nevirapine induce CYP3A4. It's hard to see, I know. Only rilpivirine has dependent pH absorption. So the second two is, C is only efavirenz, CYP3A4, and rilpivirine pH dependent is D. So again, quite a distribution. One person decided to press number 5, which I quite like. I would do something like that just to see if it works, but we'll see. So we go next. Quick, okay. Last one, let me get into the information. So what can be said about the class of integrase inhibitors? None of them inhibit CYP3A4. They do not cause DDIs at all. All of them interact with cations like magnesium, calcium, iron. Dolutegravir has a pH-dependent absorption. So which one of them? Or number 5, you don't know yet. Hopefully you will know by the end. See if I can get to the next one. Oh, again, this, hope it was the same person who said number 5 again. But I see there's quite a large distribution. And they're actually, David, they're quite tough questions, actually. But hopefully, over the next 15 minutes, 20 minutes, we'll be able to try to improve and see where we go. So the outline of the presentation is really this. There's an introduction to the causes of drug-drug interactions, quite a general introduction. Then looking at different specific classes of interactions, the epidemiology of DDIs, some new data coming out from 2006 of the newer drugs, type of drug-drug interactions, important resources you can use. Nobody, not even David, can remember all of the different drug-drug interactions, so you need to have some support with this. We go back through the multiple choice and hopefully we see some changes and then a conclusion. So this is a very, very basic slide. So pharmacokinetics, I'm sure you hear this term a lot, it's the study of the drug in the body. But really, and you break it down, it's looking at the absorption, distribution, metabolism, and elimination of the drug. And when we think about drug-drug interactions, we're going to really look at these four different processes of how the drug interaction is occurring. Is it at the absorption, is it at the distribution, et cetera, metabolism or elimination? So once you can understand the mechanism of the drug-drug interaction, maybe you'll become more proficient in trying to predict the type of drug-drug interaction. So here's a little bit of a definition. Here we have victim. So this is really the drug that is being impacted. So I added a cartoon because I can never remember these. So victim is like somebody who something's maybe bad going to happen to it. And the perpetrator is the causing the interaction, so the sort of the bad guy in the drug-drug interaction. So you have the victim and the perpetrator. So often we say, which drug is the victim, which drug is the perpetrator? And I try to put some pictures so we can easily remember which is which. So first, if we go into absorption, we know that in absorption, drug transporters are very important. So if you currently, apart from the long-acting drugs, all of the antiretrovirals are going to orally administered. So they have to get through the stomach, have to go into the intestinal tract, get across to be absorbed, and then get through the liver and into the general circulation. And a lot of it is passive diffusion, but also the drug transporters are very, very important. So if you have any drugs which go through the same transporter or can block transporters, it can cause problems. And here's just a very simple cartoon where you have drug A. It wants to get in from the blood to the liver by this transporter, OATP1, and then it's in. And it can be metabolized, it could be effective in the cell for like a hepatitis C drug. So this is, in this case, it's the victim, because you have a perpetrator who is going to block that drug getting into the cell, therefore it's kept out of its site of action. So this is a drug-drug transporter, a simple idea of how it works. But also in absorption, as well as drug transporters, often the drug has to get from the stomach then into the intestine. So it has to, depending on the physiochemical properties of the drug, it has to be dissolved. Then it has to be maybe broken up. So, and the pH is very important. So if you have a drug where the pH in your stomach is changing, or it's binding to something else in the stomach, this can affect it getting out into the intestine absorbed. So obviously, in this case, the perpetrator, the bad guy, is things which maybe change the pH in the stomach or other things that you take at the same time. And this is the more famous one. When we talk about drug-drug interactions, we always think about the liver and the cytochrome enzymes, the phase one enzymes, the CYPs. Particularly, you see CYP3A4 is the most predominant cytochrome, along with 2D6. But then the phase two enzymes, the UGTs. So when you hear someone say, oh, it's metabolized by a cytochrome enzyme, people automatically think, this drug probably has a high chance of drug-drug interactions. Similar for UGTs. But if you have something like 3TC, which is just renally excreted unchanged, it's much easier to manage because there's very, very limited drug-drug interactions. And here's the idea of the metabolism. Here's like a liver cell. You have drug A, drug B. Here, drug A is the victim, drug B is the perpetrator, and what drug B is going to come in and do, drug A is happy, it's just going to be metabolized by this enzyme CYP3A4, but then this perpetrator comes along, it then says, I'm going to induce more enzyme, and therefore what happens? It's metabolized faster and it decreases. So in this situation, that everything without that drug is no problem. You add this one on, it causes an induction, the mechanism can differ, but basically it's going to be metabolized faster. And here we have a sort of summary of here we have David tried to make a table of the victim versus the perpetrator. Here you have a metabolism enzyme inducer, or inhibitor inducer for the transporter, and then the victim, so how it's metabolized. So here's a little tip for one of the questions that we have, so listen to what I say here. So you see that efavirenz, as well as nevirapine, is metabolized by CYP. Rilpivirine is metabolized by CYP. But you see here, rilpivirine, it's not an inducer of any of the cytochrome enzymes. Big hint. So you have efavirenz, again, it's an inducer. Nevirapine is also an inducer of CYP3A4. While ritonavir, you see, and the protease inhibitors in general, all of them are cytochrome CYP3A4. So they're going to have a huge amount of drug-drug interactions. So protease inhibitors have major drug-drug interactions, especially compared to the other classes, because of the ritonavir, which is a massive inhibitor and inducer of different cytochrome enzymes. So PIs out of the antiretrovirals have the main risk of drug-drug interactions, let's say. While you see the integrase at the bottom,
You see they're not really inducers of the enzymes, but they're mainly UGT metabolized compared to the cytochrome. So their risk of drug-drug interactions is less. For tenofovir, it's interesting, it's not metabolized by the cytochrome, but it does have potential drug-drug interactions. This is particularly of transporters in the renal tubules because it's secreted through the tubular secretion. So I think it's on both the previous presentations we talk about polypharmacy. So we know that the number of drugs for ARVs, the main objective is to get less. So now one tablet once a day. But then the opposite side, because of people getting older, the number of tablets increases. So the ARV drugs are going down, excellent, maybe an injection in the future, and then no tablets. But you still have now, obviously, tuberculosis, statin treatment, GERD, heart disease, hormonal contraceptions, and many other drugs which are not, I mean, just from the local pharmacy, which are given, herbal reagents, which can then add up over time. And if you look at the aging, and I think we've seen this slide already, if you're less than 50, more than 50, basically as you get older, the number of drugs you take is more. It's not some relationship here. And again, the type of drugs they're taking, we just saw vitamins. I mean, as people get older, they believe vitamins will be helpful for them. They have a lot of pain as well, and depressed. They take some steroids. You know, here's the statins, again, very high. Antifungal and anticoagulant is very interesting as well. So you can see that these are probably expected, the type of drugs, but these are the same in HIV uninfected, but as you get older, the number of tablets is increasing. And this is interesting, actually. If you look at this, so we know that there's polypharmacy, but here, if you just look, example, in this study, you see for the statins, there was 50 in this, I think it was a cohort study, I guess, they looked at 50 patients on statins, but 20% of those people on that statin were contraindicated. So they were using them, but then the contraindication of it, so it's quite high. Even for the proton pump inhibitors, 61% of the proton people who were using proton pump inhibitors had a contraindication with the ARV treatment. So there's a lot of people giving these drugs, but they're really not maybe considering as much as perhaps they should the possible drug-drug interactions. So if I had to name one drug interaction, if everyone had to ask you, name one drug-drug interaction, they would always say, oh, it's the TB drugs with the PIs. And this is probably the most famous ones, if you have to talk about TB, rifampicin with the protease inhibitors. And this is because lopinavir is metabolized by CYP3A4, and rifampicin, as we saw, would be the inducer, the perpetrator, to induce the enzyme. And here it is alone. This is the concentration time curve. You give it with rifampicin, you see a 70% reduction. And you can overcome this, though, by just doubling the dose. So you could give, instead of giving 400, 100 twice a day, you'd give 800, 200 twice a day plus rifampicin, you get the same AUC. What's why I use this example, actually. So that's a good example how to overcome the interaction. Okay, you double the dose, and it looks pretty good. But in children, when they tried to do this, it didn't work. So you tried, they take lopinavir with TB, they reduce it. Okay, we doubled the dose as well, but it didn't work. So it's interesting that the drug-drug interaction, I mean, there's probably a few exceptions where the solution in adults may not also be the solution in children. So we have to take that into consideration. Here is a slide, and I only really saw the presentation yesterday, so I didn't really know what these were. To be honest, David put this up, so I tried to quickly look on Wikipedia what they were. So these are things like shark cartilage, carver, yomindi, and these do many different things. So they're basically complementary medicines that people are using, or maybe from their local community that they can access. And basically, it's known about these herbs, so they're going to be taking these herbs and maybe they inhibit these enzymes, like we say, the cytochrome enzymes, and could have, without any knowledge, a major drug-drug interaction. And of course, the worst scenarios are that it decreases the drug, so the virological failure, or it increases the drug and you have higher risk of toxicity. So either situation could occur, but you have to be really careful about using these complementary, say, and alternative medicines over the counter, and you have to ask the patients, are you using such products, and maybe try to find some information about them. If they're taking shark cartilage, maybe you would know in advance, I don't know. So then we come to a very common drug like the antacid. So these, I think probably everyone in the room over a certain age has taken an antacid or at some point, I'm sure, but it's a very, very commonly used, but we have to be really careful, actually. Because it's common, doesn't mean that there's no interactions. So here, for the integrase, what's very interesting, they need, through their mechanism action, a cation motif. But then if you're giving these acid-reducing agents, it can really interfere with the the absorption. So here's raltegravir with antacids. If you give, it actually gives, raltegravir alone is the is this one here. If you give it with an antacid, it really reduces the concentrations quite significantly. So that's interesting that if you give raltegravir antacids, you go down, so then that could be a problem. And actually, you always have to remember when people talk to me about PK, they say, oh, okay, you do your PK, it's very interesting, but what's the real outcome of it? Okay, you have a 67% lower. What does that mean clinically? Is it still okay? Can we still give it? But actually, you see here, and I mean, again, it's just a case report, but you see you people have virological failure while on raltegravir and calcium. I could not access the paper, but what it suggests is that, again, this as occurs, it may have a clinical impact, so we have to be really careful about that and really look into the more care of that. But on the opposite side, we see raltegravir is reduced with antacids, but you give it with a proton pump inhibitor, it goes up. So that's very interesting because here, it's a little bit complicated, I think. Raltegravir, the solubility in the stomach is not so good, so when you increase the gastric pH, it actually, the solubility becomes better, so then it can be absorbed more. So here you have a bit of a sort of a conflict. So I'll give an antacid, it goes down. I give a protease inhibitor, it goes up. So it's a little bit complicated. So you can see that it's not so simple. What about another integrase, dorvaltegravir? As I said, that for the integrase, you need this cation for its sort of motif within the molecule to give it some sort of its mechanism of action. And you see when they give dorvaltegravir here, this is the red one is dorvaltegravir alone. Then you give it with some calcium carbonate, it actually, the dorvaltegravir goes down. So sorry, the red one is dorvaltegravir with a calcium carbonate in the fasted state, about 39% decrease. If you give it with ferrous fermate, the red one again with ferrous in the fasted, it's gone down. So you see that, again, similar to raltegravir, you give it with sort of cation agents, it's decreasing. What's interesting here, though, if you give it 2 hours before, or you give it just in the fed state, you could overcome this effect. But I think the recommendation is actually to give it 2 hours before or 6 hours after. But actually, what was interesting, if you give it with food, you see, I think it's this, the green one, you see that in both cases, it actually, the effect was minimal. And here it's just the same dorvaltegravir with multivitamins. You see it goes down. Here it's with antacids. But again, we just saw with raltegravir, you have the decrease with the antacids, increase with omeprazole. But here you have the decrease with the antacids, but you have no effect of omeprazole. So you see that here again, even within the same class, you have this different sort of drug-drug interactions which will occur. The last integrase, altegravir, as you would expect, also reduces with antacids, and you have to separate it by at least 4 hours. So here's a sort of a summary table of the victim drug here, and here's the antiretroviral. So rilpivirine, again, hint to look at the questions. It's reduced here, actually. You see here, for all of the integrase, you see the chelation or the effect of the cation, while for the raltegravir, it's the only one which is pH-dependent. So dorvaltegravir is not pH-dependent. So looking at other drugs, there's a few other examples here. This is an anticoagulant, rivaroxaban. When you give it here, the perpetrator has now swapped. So all of the ones we've talked to so far is that the antiretroviral has been the victim. But now here we've switched it, so the antiretroviral is the perpetrator, and here the oral coagulant is the victim. And here, similarly with cobicistat, so the booster, with dabigatran, I think that's how you pronounce it. You see here, the antiretroviral is the perpetrator, so you have this anticoagulant effect is of the drug, its concentrations are increased. You see the thrombin time here is extended. This is throughout the dosing interval, so it's quite high here, and then the thrombin timing is decreasing. But you see with the heart, in the presence of the cobicistat, the thrombin time is extended. This slide is just really, again, maybe just a reference that you could look at. And as we know, as you're getting older, there's more cancers. HIV-infected patients will be treated for cancer. And we can't go into all of the details of this, but again, with cancer drugs, if the cytochromes or drug transporter interactions, there's many risks of that. So this is just highlighting that you're going to have to be very, very careful when coming into giving cancer treatment with specific antiretrovirals. I think this is the last interaction we have, and this is looking at doraltegravir with a very common anti-hyperglycemic agent, metformin, which is used for glucose tolerance in type 2 diabetes. Now, actually, you would not expect a lot of drug interactions with metformin because we say it's not excreted by the cytochrome enzymes. It's mainly excreted in the urine. But as it passes through the urine, it uses certain drug transporters to get it through the renal tubule cells and then out into the urine. So you see that doraltegravir is an inhibitor of OCT2 transporter. So when you give them together, you see the metformin concentration is increased quite high by about 79%. So again here, the antiretroviral is the perpetrator, increasing the concentration of the metformin. And here's just the supposed, or probably hypothesis mechanism of action where the doraltegravir is blocking. This is just an example of what goes through the tubule cell, here that the doraltegravir is probably blocking the OCT2 cell and then the metformin concentrations are increasing. So actually they would recommend maybe a dose adjustment in the, with doraltegravir with metformin to get an optimal effect. So as I said, it's impossible to constantly remember, oh, this drug interacts with this and drug. I mean, within half an hour of this presentation, probably most of you have forgotten most of the interactions I've talked about. So, or even less, maybe, I don't know. So here, but here you have a very nice database with the HIV drug interactions in Liverpool, where you, I think they have an app where you can quickly go through. But when thinking about drug-drug interactions, David has proposed these six steps. So again, the first step would be, is there an interaction? And if there's so, maybe it's already known, go onto the Liverpool website, plug in your two drugs, and they'll tell you. Think about which is the perpetrator, which is the victim, and what is the risk for each one. Consult treating physician whether they could, if it's possible to have an adjustment. Many people say, oh, adjust the dose, but actually there's only one tablet at one formulation, so it's not possible to adjust, to switch it to something else. Modify ARVs. This is an important one. Consult a clinical pharmacologist, and you can send an email to David, maybe. And then you obviously have to monitor closely all of the interactions. So that's the end of the presentation. We go back. I'll put it on quickly. So which of the following classes is responsible for the majority of drug-drug interactions? The protease inhibitors, now you know how they metabolize, integrase, NRTIs, or NNRTIs? I cannot remember what there was. I think it was quite an equal spread before. I am predicting you will improve. The answer I will tell you now actually is A. So let's see what you got. That's not too bad. Some improvement, I think, so not everyone was asleep so far. Let's try the next one. Next. Let's go. So what is true about the class of NNRTIs? This is a little bit of a harder question, I must admit. So of the NNRTIs, are they all inhibitors of CYP3A4? Are they all, this is the key word, all inhibitors of CYP2D6? Only efavirenz and nevirapine are inducers? Only rilpivirine has pH-dependent absorption. Can you remember what it is? I will tell you the answer with 2 seconds left. So the answer is D. So I think this was a little bit of a trick question from David, actually. When we talk about, similar to the protease inhibitors, the NNRTIs, we think efavirenz, nevirapine, etrovirin, but in Thailand we don't really use a lot, and rilpivirine is increasing. But actually the answer is because, you say they are all inhibitors, or these two, rilpivirine does not induce or inhibit cytochrome enzymes. So it's one of the NNRTIs which actually has quite good drug-drug interaction profile. I think in the clinical development, you give 25 milligrams clinically, but in the development I think they give 300 milligrams and it could induce a little bit. But it's irrelevant because they only give 25. But I think if you think of NNRTIs, think, okay, yes, most of them have interactions, but rilpivirine, the interactions with cytochrome enzymes is limited. Okay, the last one. So what can be said about the integrase? I talk a bit about integrase. None of them are an inhibitor of CYP3A4. They do not cause DDIs at all. All of them can interact with cations. Doraltegravir has a pH-dependent absorption. So, which one is it? I will tell you the answer with 2 seconds left. So the answer is A. No, it's not. It's C. Okay. So, and actually, that's funny you should say that, because I think there is a trick question here, actually, is again from David. So the answer is C, that all of them interact with cations, as we saw with antacids. Raltegravir, L-valtegravir, dolvaltegravir, all reduced with the antacids. Not the same for the PPIs with omeprazole, but for the antacids with the cations, they are all reduced. Now, none of them are inhibitor of CYP3A4. I think that's true, actually, because technically L-valtegravir does not, dolvaltegravir and raltegravir do not inhibit any of them. But I think he says that L-valtegravir has to be given with cobicistat. So that group is actually, and cobicistat is an inhibitor of CYP3A4. So I would not be disappointed with the 8, so it's not too bad. You can pat yourself on that one, it's okay. So last slide. So in summary, ART is a lifelong treatment, and it's common that other drugs will be prescribed over time. It's inevitable. But we have to think that of those drug-drug interactions, we have to think, is this interaction at the absorption part? Like I said, drug transporters, but also the antacid kind of things, drug distribution. I didn't talk about this, but this is mainly talk about protein binding. Metabolism, classically the cytochrome enzymes, and elimination maybe in the renal tubules, drug transporters as well. So clearly it's important to identify drug directions and see what the impact is on efficacy and safety. And this is David's final slides. He's from Nijmegen, and I think this is a football team, and these are his team there. So I'm sure he's disappointed he can't make it. Thank you.
Talk. I think you actually did an excellent job replacing David.
Well, the slides yesterday, isn't it?
Yeah. Are there any questions for Dr. Cressy? Yeah.
Thank you for excellent presentation. I'd like to ask you about one question. You talk about the interaction between rifamycin and lopinavir in the children. And even when we increase the double dose of lopinavir, it did not work. So what should we do in the developing country, especially in my country? We do not have anything else.
Yeah, this is an excellent question because it's disappointing. Always the children has the bad end of the stick. You could say that the adults, okay, you can double, but for the children, you cannot. So I know that there is a study in South Africa, and I think it's already finished, where they give the super boosting of the ritonavir. So they give equal amount of lopinavir and ritonavir. This is not, by no suggestion, it's ideal, because you have to give more ritonavir liquid, and ritonavir liquid is horrible. So it does, from a pharmacokinetic standpoint, solve the problem. So if you give super boosting lopinavir, ritonavir in children, the exposure is the same, with rifampicin, is the same as lopinavir, ritonavir alone. So it solves it in terms of pharmacokinetics. But that's not the real story, because you have to, we have to think about the tolerance, the long-term tolerance of taking a super boosting, the logistics, giving two liquids or things like this. So I think it is a solution, but it's not a real programmatic solution to give on a large public health approach. So there are studies where they're thinking about you can give lopinavir pellets and other formulations which they're developing to try to overcome this sort of logistical problem, because I think it's a solution, but it's not really a practical long-term solution. If you have to do it, you should. It has to be done because you need to treat it. If there's no choice to switch lopinavir to another drug, for example. So this is the solution for now.
Any other questions? Okay, well, thank you very much, Dr. Cressy, for your talk. So we'll take a short break now and continue with the rest of the workshop in, let's say, 20 minutes. So be back here at 2:50. Thank you.